Well, still on the Maharlika Investment Fund, progressive group Bayan Muna criticizing central bank Governor Felipe Medalla for saying the proposal is now more acceptable. We'll be speaking now with the chairman of Bayan Muna, attorney Nery Colmenares. Attorney Colmenares, good afternoon to you. Thank you for joining us today. Nice to see you again.
Nice to see you too, Carmina. Thank you. Good afternoon to all your viewers.
The BSP chief there saying the MIF is more acceptable. Tell me something, attorney Colmenares. Have you seen the final version of the MIF bill? Has anyone? And what would lead Mr. Medalla to say that this is more acceptable than previous versions? Go ahead.
Yes, I don't think anyone has seen the final version. The latest final version we saw was the House approved Maharlika bill last December of 2022. So how can they say that it's more acceptable now when the bill that was actually approved by the House is not acceptable? Definitely, it's still the same central bank and land bank and DBP, which many complain as diverting resources from government mandate to help the MSMEs and the farmers, and at the same time taking away surplus dividends from the central bank, which could be used to stem to do the mandate of central bank. Inflation rate is very high right now, Carmina. It's about 8.7% from the trajectory projected by BSP, which was just like 4% before. Mm-hmm. So can you imagine the need for us to, I agree with some senators who said that how can we sleep soundly if we don't know our monetary, central monetary board can function well, right? Mm-hmm. So the second is, there is still no prohibition on the part of the Maharlika bill to address the concern of pensioners from GSIS and SSS that their pension funds will not be used there, because the bill, as approved by the House, which is so far the official copy of the bill, did not categorically say that they will not use pension funds from the GSIS, SSS, and the fact, of course, that public borrowing is still included in the bill as of now shows that not just the pensioners, but the entire taxpayers and the entire country will be burdened by the Maharlika Fund. So we still go to the question, the Maharlika Fund is not independent. Is it subject to favorite cronies? You know, this penchant of giving benefits and loans and sellouts to crony corporations. Yes, it's not there. The regulation is not there. The exemptions are still there. That's why we kept on telling the House of Representatives, why rush this bill when there is a need to even study it? No, because the president certified the bill urgent. They passed it second and third reading in one day without even giving a copy of the bill being approved to the members of the House, which is a violation of the Constitution.
Which we're going to go into right now. With the way this bill is progressing, it's progressing the way it's proceeding, and you're saying they're violating the Constitution by doing so. How exactly are they violating the Constitution?
First, we question the procedure that it was approved in the House of Representatives. It was certified urgent by President Marcos. What is the emergency? What is the calamity? Because the Constitution says any law shall pass three readings on three separate days in the House of Representatives, and the members shall be given a copy of the bill being approved 3 days before the voting. So because it was certified urgent by the President, emergency, so it was approved only in one day. Now, question, Carmina, what was the calamity being addressed? Why would the president shortcut the House when even if the House short-circuited its process, wala namang what law is passed now? What emergency is being addressed? Mm. Because the Senate is still deliberating. In fact, we're telling the president, if you want to certify, you certify it in both houses. You cannot just certify it in one house and short-circuit the procedure in that house, and that no law will be enacted anyway. So it actually is a fatal admission on the part of Malacanang that there was no calamity because they did not even bother to certify it in the Senate. That's why the Senate is still deliberating. When will the Senate approve it? 1 year from now? 1 month from now? Who knows? The fact is, there is no emergency sufficient to trigger a certification of urgency precisely because it has been passed by the House in December. Now we're going into March. It's not even a law yet. So yeah, we question the constitutionality and we will question the constitutionality of this, but also the abuse of presidential certification of emergency, not just under President Marcos, but even in the many previous administrations which certified bills as urgent when they do not deserve a certification of urgency, and but in fact deserve a careful study and scrutiny by both houses of Congress instead of swift and immediate passage without deliberations.
Attorney Colmenares, is it clear, is it any clearer to you now where the funds will be sourced, where these funds will be invested, when the ROI will be, and what specifically will be the gains of the Filipino people given a certain amount of time? Is that clear?
It's not clear. In fact, now they're going to source it from the NDC, the National Development Corporation. I think that's a violation of the charter of the NDC. The NDC is supposed to fund investments in pioneering industries. And very important, I mean, NDC's role in investing or supporting pioneering industries, industries where foreign investors will not invest, is very important. I can just cite some industries a long time ago which they could have supported. For example, at the time when nobody was investing on renewable energy, NDC should have been there. Now they're going to invest not on pioneering industries, but on mining, on real estate, and so on, which is where Maharlika Fund will supposedly be invested. That is a violation, of course, of their charter. And another thing is a violation of the needs of the Filipino people. What is clear for now, Carmina, among all those questions you raised, the only thing clear is that the Filipino people will not really benefit from this, because why have a sovereign wealth fund in a situation where we don't have surplus wealth? Wala tayong surplus wealth. It will only increase the debt problem of the country, more debts for us. And I'm very sure corruption will set in also in the Maharlika Fund once it is implemented as an investment fund now, and because of its lack of independence and lack of regulation of the whole concept.
Attorney Colmenares, if that is clear to you, then why are they pushing it? What is the reason? What is the reason behind the urgency?
I don't really see that, Carmina. I mean, initially they're going to get it from GSIS and SSS, but GSIS and SSS also invest. I mean, why centralize it? NDC also invests. Now they're talking of NDC. So the only thing, the only difference is now you centralize the funds. So it's not unreasonable for people to think, oh, you're centralizing the funds, so it's easier to, you know, that's more, and even, you know, subject to corruption. Why centralize it when there are checks and balance in all these GFIs every time they invest? Of course, if the SSS or GSIS invest in something foolhardy, at least the pensioners and the members have the right to say, why are you doing that? But if you centralize it in the Maharlika Fund, Carmina, investment decisions will not be transparent. In fact, despite their pronouncement that it will be open to the public, it will be open to the public much, much, much later.
Okay, but let me just cut you there before we run out of time. Still, yes. I go back to my question. If there are all these red flags that you are raising, and you're not alone, there are many others out there who are saying this cannot be done at this point, right? The intention is there, well and good, but with the current state of the economy and the current version that they're giving the public, it raises more questions than answers. So if that's the case, then why the push for it, Attorney Colmenares?
Well, we don't really know, but there are, of course, concerns about this could be subjected to corruption. This could be subjected to money laundering. This could be subject to crony capitalism. where you fund your friends and in the, you know, in of course, that's a negative thing for the other investors or companies who are not friends, right? So all these things come into play now because the purpose is not clear, except to say, oh, if we have this fund and we can invest, we will earn. How? You mentioned we don't even know the RBI. You know, what's the return rate here? And you deplete much needed resources that can be used by the farmers in land bank, by the small and medium enterprises in DBP, and now the NDC for pioneering industries and so on. And even the Banco Central, when in fact we need all the funds regulatory, you know, for Banco Central to regulate this increasing inflation, accounts deficit, trade deficit, all these things, these financial deficits we have. So, I guess they're increasing base points in terms of the central bank is increasing base points for interest rates, but they will give a lot of billions and of pesos again on something instead of dividends, for example. The BSP dividends in 2020 and 2021 was able to help in the COVID response. Mm-hmm. So now where are you going to get all these funds? Because mm-hmm. the dividends will be given 100%, at least in the first 2 years, to this Maharlika, amorphous, vague concept called the Maharlika Fund. It's not worth it, Carmina, and it must be defeated in the Senate, at least for now, and hopefully even in the Supreme Court.
Well, we're going to get to that in a bit. But first, you know, if things go unabated, if things go as they're going, you already said that clearly the Filipino people, the way you see it, will not benefit from the Maharlika Fund. But if things go the way they go, what do you think awaits the Filipino people if this is passed?
Well, for me, just immediately the deprivation of benefits, loans for farmers and small and medium enterprises, definitely will impact on them. The viability of these government financial institutions, there will be an impact, definitely. Mm-hmm. And you're not just going to give 50, 100, 200 billion pesos, and if you lose it, then there's no impact. There will be an impact even on the depositors of this bank. Mm. Thirdly, there will be an impact on all taxpayers because of the debt burden. It will increase the debt burden. And of course, fourthly, of course, it's a depletion of public funds. Pinaghirapan ng taxpayers yan. And then you deplete it in one insane concept called the Maharlika Investment Fund. Really, there are so many other things and projects and worthwhile tasks that the government can spend their money on rather than on such, for me, an insane and absurd concept that will centralize all these important and necessary government resources into one centralized fund called the Maharlika Investment
Fund. What gives you hope, though, that this won't happen? I mean, you look at the Senate, and there are some senators who are voicing out their misgivings about and their apprehensions about the creation of such a fund. But then again, you look the other way and you see and realize that there is a supermajority backing this proposal. So what gives you?
I'm heartened by the, you know, the concerns and the opposition, of course, of Senator Coco Pimentel, Risa Ontiveros, and concerns expressed by senators like Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. I hope a lot of senators will study this well and not approve this. In fact, the concept itself is for me, foolhardy. But I understand, yes, there's a super majority there, but we're talking of public funds, Carmina. We're talking of people's funds, much needed funds. This should go beyond majority minority here. Mm. This should cross the aisle, so to speak.
But what else and can second, be done? What else can be done, Attorney Colmenares? Well, because it seems to a lot of people now that even if there's opposition voicing the concerns, this voice is getting drowned by those who support it, who are supportive of it. Go ahead.
Yes. Well, I'm hopeful of in the Supreme Court because I think our petition was very clear that it's unconstitutional. So we're still hopeful there. But most importantly, I think it's the people's response here. Government, you know, I've learned a lesson there in my 3 terms in Congress. Paminsan-minsan ang gobyerno napipilitang gawin ang hindi niya gusto depende sa pagtutol ng tao sa labas ng Kongreso. And for me, that lesson is there. And the most important arena for the struggle here is the Filipino people themselves, who will be burdened by this Maharlika Fund. We should keep on the protest, whether in social media or in the streets. We should do that because it must be a comprehensive effort for us to stop this, not only in the halls of Congress, not only in the Supreme Court, but also, as I mentioned, hindi lang yan sa korte, hindi lang sa Kongreso, kundi sa kalye. Kailangan ilaban to ng mamamaya na siya talaga ang magkakaroon ng parusa dito sa Maharlika Fund.
Well, while we have you here, Attorney Colmenares, I just want to get your insights on one other pressing issue. You know what's been happening at the House of Representatives regarding the issue of holding a constitutional convention? We just spoke with Congressman Rufus Rodriguez just this morning. We were talking about the cost, and this is what he said. He said that people should start looking at it and not as an expense, the 10,000 peso allowance per day, but as an investment. Your thoughts?
I'll go further than that, Carmina. The bills in the House, when I was there as a resource speaker together with the former Commissioner Christian Monsod, there were two sets of bills. Huh? The first proposal was for term extension from 3 years to 5 years for all government officials, from congressmen down to the councillors. The second term extension is that the president will now be allowed two terms. Instead of one term now, the president of the Republic will have two terms, just like the vice president. So a president can now be up for re-election. Do I agree with that? Of course not. This is a self-serving cha-cha if you're going to amend the constitution because of term extension. The second, of course, is the opening up of the economy. They keep on harping that there are people investing in Malaysia, in Indonesia, in Vietnam, whatever, in China. But I mentioned during the hearings, look, can foreigners buy land in China? Of course not. Can Vietnamese buy lands in China? Of course not. The Chinese cannot even buy their own land in China because it's a different system altogether there. So why are their investors you mentioned there? Maybe the problem here is not the issue of ownership of lands or 60-40, etc., but rather the corruption and the bureaucracy and the lack of infrastructure and so on. And secondly, is investor really the main engine of growth? For me, Carmina, no. Lahat na lang ng presidente, all presidents who went abroad, every time they arrived, I brought with me $100 million of investment, 200. Nothing came out. There had been laws that already sort of allowed them in, but we didn't advance. For me, the main engine of growth is national industrialization. Buhos kapital at suporta ang gobyerno sa lokal na negosyo at industriya. For me, foreign investments are important, but that's secondary engine of growth. The first engine of growth, which fueled Japan, South Korea, US, England, all these countries, is national industrialization, not foreign investment. So where is their economies coming from? And lastly, Carmina, ang ating kahirapan at ang korupsyon hindi nagmumula sa konstitusyon. Kaya ang pag-amienda dito ay hindi solusyon. So why spend that 10,000 pesos or 100,000 pesos, 5 billion pesos? Why even spend 1 peso on something that is not going to solve anything? Because that's not the problem. If we cannot stop corruption, Carmina, kahit mag-cha-cha tayo 10 times a year, mag-cha-cha tayo taon-taon, walang mangyayaring pag-uunlad sa atin. Pag isolve nyo ang korupsyon, yung contractualization, isolve nyo ang basic problems ng Philippine society, hindi nyo na nga kailangan mag-cha-cha Uunlad tayo. Pero they keep on harping and the Filipino people again are going to spend a lot of money just to feed these delegates who, unless, sabi nga, this is a challenge to both houses of Congress. You want cha-cha? You want election of CONCON delegates? One delegate per district? You first pass the anti-dynasty law. First pass it, and then let's see. Let's discuss about this post-constitutional convention, because without the passage of an anti-dynasty law, then the whole CONCON will still be controlled by a majority of the dynasties. You want to tinker with the constitution? You do what the constitution requires. Pass the anti-dynasty law, and then we can discuss about other possible changes in the constitution.
Attorney Nery Colmenares there, Chairman of Bayan Muna. Always a pleasure talking to you. Thanks for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
Salamat po. Thank you.